Good morning, and welcome to Stetson Law School. I'm Professor Jason Bent. I'm the faculty advisor to the Stetson Law Review. And on behalf of the Law Review, and with the generous support of Dean Chris Petrushkevich, the Corporate Reform Coalition, and the Stetson chapter of the American Constitution Society, let me be the first to welcome you to Stetson Law and to today's symposium. We are pleased that you could join us today for a timely discussion of the role of corporations and businesses and the role that they play in our democracy. Today we've assembled a learned group of thought leaders who work on various aspects of the issue of corporate role in our democratic process. We have journalists, we have lawyers, we have reformers, we have political scientists, we have a scientist, and of course we have an entrepreneur. From the point of view of the First Amendment, the role of corporations have had two big turning points at the U.S. Supreme Court. One was in the 1970s when the Supreme Court decided in Virginia Pharmacy that corporations have protectable commercial speech rights, and then also in Bilotti when that corporations have protectable rights to spend in ballot initiative fights. Then for decades, the Supreme Court actually upheld laws which gave corporations fewer speech rights than human beings in candidate elections. And for decades, the question then was raised, what types of political rights could be credibly claimed by corporations as opposed to human beings? Then in 2010, the Supreme Court granted corporations the ability to buy as many independent ads as they could afford in political circumstances in Citizens United. And in 2014, in Burwell versus Hobby Lobby, the Supreme Court granted for-profit, closely held corporations the statutory right under RFRA to assert religious objections to generally applicable laws. While some corporations are exercising their right to spend in candidate elections, most corporate political spending is actually spent on lobbying legislators and administrative agencies. Meanwhile, there have been strong negative reactions to the expansion of corporate political power and corporate political spending, ranging from efforts to get more transparency through legislation and rules, to efforts to amend the U.S. Constitution, to amend the U.S. Constitution to reserve political and religious rights to only human beings. And another approach is to try to get corporations to reform themselves internally through the creation of benefits corporations or by using traditional mechanisms of corporate democracy to vote for more transparency. So when we originally planned this symposium, this topic was primarily of interest to academics and reformers and of special interest to Professor Torres-Spelliscy. But many of these issues have now drawn the attention of average citizens as they see a new president who refuses to divest from his own businesses and his business empire. Thus, over the last few months, you've seen the press has been full of stories of conflicts of interest between the president's businesses and his duties as the commander-in-chief. This raises a whole host of new and complex issues for the role of businesses in politics. So it seems that today's discussion has taken on a new sense of urgency, at least from when we originally planned it. We are incredibly grateful for all of our guests who traveled from near and far to be with us today to share their insights on these questions. We also have one speaker who will be joining us from California remotely. And I want to take this opportunity to especially thank Professor Torres-Spelliscy, who is really the driving force behind this symposium and the organizer of this symposium. And of course, we are lucky to have with us later today Ben Cohen from Ben & Jerry's, which is why you're all here, right? The ice cream. He'll be giving our keynote address over lunch. So with that introduction, please let me get out of the way and join me in welcoming our first panel, who's going to get our discussion started with a discussion of the big picture of how corporations and democracy interact.
Elizabeth, are you still with us?
Yes, indeed.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Is this working? Are you working here? Can you hear me? Okay, I can talk loudly.
I can hear.
Okay, there we go. I'm Kathy Kiely. I hope you're fully caffeinated, but we hope that you won't need that caffeine because we've got a lively panel and day ahead of us. And there's chocolates on the table too, so that should be good. I'm really glad to see that for this first panel, we don't have any worries about mantles at this event. And I am the only person on this panel who is neither a lawyer nor an aspiring lawyer. And I think I know why Ciara invited me. It is because I'm possibly the only person who make lawyers in the public eye look popular. I'm a journalist. So you can feel good when you're comparing yourself to me. Now, and I'm actually quite familiar with this part of Florida because as a political journalist, I've been here a lot. This is kind of like the swing, Pinellas County is the swing precincts of the swingiest part of the state, and this is definitely a state of swingers, at least politically speaking, so I know this part of Florida well, and I'm glad to be here. And journalists like to come up with these clever memes to describe what we're writing about, and one of the most famous of those, of course, was created by Henry Luce, the publisher of Time magazine, who invented this Man of the Year. It used to be Man of the Year, now it's Person of the Year, although I was amused to note that back in 1975 when Time named American Women to their cover, it was still Man of the Year. But if we were to pick a person of this young century, or certainly the decade, as Professor Bent described, that started in 2010, I think it would have to be the corporation. Because, as our Supreme Court continually reminds us, corporations are persons too. And as a political journalist, this has been really interesting for me to watch because corporations, unlike natural persons, don't have a biological lifespan. So they have abilities to amass fortunes and power that are beyond what natural persons have, and that gives them power. And corporations also are extraterritorial. And if you can be more than one place at once, you can often avoid being regulated in any place. And that creates some interesting dilemmas for journalists and for government regulators. So I'm really excited that we're going to be discussing this today with some people who are very, very smart about corporations and corporate law. And the first of those is Elizabeth Pollman, who is Skyping in from California, where it's really, really early. And at Los Angeles, she teaches at the Loyola University Law School. So Elizabeth, we're not going to ask you if you're still wearing your jammies, but we won't blame you if you are, but we're eager to hear your take on what it means for corporations to be persons. So go for it.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Great. Excellent. Well, thanks to Professor Torres-Spelliscy and the Law Review and Kathy and everybody there, and apologies that I can't be there in person. I have so much gratitude for still being able to participate, and I am not wearing my pajamas. But I would love to turn to my second slide, which has a quote from Professor Torres-Spelliscy's excellent book, and I thought it would be a great starting place. I worried that Professor Torres-Spelliscy might be a little bit modest about highlighting her own book, because it really is wonderful, and I think it sets the stage for many of the themes of today's symposium. So I wanted to start with a quote, and it's not even one of her most provocative quotes, but I think it's wonderful because it shows how embedded in this quote are a few very important points that I'd like to emphasize in my own remarks today. So are we at slide two with
the
quote?
Yes,
corporations, yeah. Corporations have long held a panoply of rights, from contract rights to property rights to due process rights. But the rights that she wanted to focus on in the book are of a narrow variety. Let me add a little commentary. They're narrow, but now they're quite expansive for corporations. Americans' First Amendment rights, including commercial speech, political speech, and religious rights. Over the past 40 years, courts have methodically been expanding First Amendment rights for all corporations, from a one-person sole proprietorship to the largest multinational. And the points that I'd like to emphasize that are embedded here are about the history of corporate rights, about what's at stake in this debate, and about the diverse spectrum of corporations. So starting from the beginning, and going to this next slide with the timeline, I thought I would really start at the beginning. I get the pleasure of speaking in the morning and having a few remarks about the broadest kind of table setting. And the first point to make is that the U.S. Constitution uses the term persons and citizens, but it does not refer to corporations. And so that poses the question of how corporations should be treated under the Constitution. And at core, this is largely a question of the power dynamic between corporations and the government, and how and under what circumstances corporations can be regulated. And that's really what's at stake with these questions about corporate personhood or corporate rights. And sometimes in the public conversation, I think that can get lost because people get so taken aback by this idea of corporations as persons. But really what's at stake is about how we can regulate corporations in our society and what that power dynamic is. And in the debate about corporate personhood or what rights corporations should have under the Constitution, most people have actually recognized that corporations should not have all of the same rights. And that's because corporations are not the same as human individuals. And the Supreme Court has actually never mistaken corporations for actual human individuals. But many people also recognize that corporations should have some rights. And many people would say that's to protect the rights of natural persons who are organizing and carrying out their activities through corporations. So the difficult questions here are about which corporations get which rights and how to determine that. And that's where, and from my perspective, most of the ball game is really with these questions of corporate rights, is which corporations, which rights, and how to figure it out. And the Supreme Court hasn't addressed these issues in a holistic way. Rather, the Supreme Court has made incremental decisions on a case-by-case basis and without a unified theory of the corporation, which has led to inconsistencies in the court's reasoning, and it's allowed for the rapid expansion of rights that we've seen in recent years. So over time, on an ad hoc basis, the court has recognized corporations as having a panoply of rights, which one might think of in terms of three categories that I have here in historical chronology. First, we had rights associated with contract and property interests, and these represent the earliest cases starting from the early 1800s. The court recognized corporations as having the protection of the contract clause, and by the later 1800s, the court also had recognized corporations as having protections of the 14th and 5th Amendments in the context of guarding corporate property. The court also, though notably, denied recognizing corporations as citizens under the Privileges and Immunities Clause. And the court, basically, in the 1800s, you could sum it up as having accorded limited protections to corporations, recognizing that they represent an important tool for pooling and deploying private resources, but at the same time recognizing that they're not the same thing as natural persons. And that was really the jurisprudence through the 1800s. Once we got to the early 1900s, we started to see additional rights being recognized for corporations associated with searches and trials. And by the early 1900s, courts had started holding corporations vicariously liable for the criminal acts that were performed by their agents. So in 1909, for instance, in New York Central, the Supreme Court definitively recognized corporate criminal liability based on the doctrine of respondeat superior. And around that time, the court held in Hale v. Henkel that a corporation didn't have Fifth Amendment rights against self-incrimination, but did have a Fourth Amendment right against unreasonable searches and seizures. So it was around the time of recognizing corporate criminal liability that the court also accorded certain protections related to searches and trials, but not all the same as a natural person. And it seems pragmatism may have been driving the court's decisions in this area. Granting corporations the privilege against self-incrimination could have significantly impeded corporate criminal prosecutions that were starting to grow at the time, whereas recognizing corporations as having some right against unreasonable government searches and seizures wouldn't entirely shield corporations from such enforcement. And notably, with the court's logic in this area, searches and seizures and trials seems to have been at least a part with simply giving corporations some of the protections that any criminal defendant would have in the system. It was not on the basis of thinking that corporations were literally natural persons. And that is also partly why perhaps the Supreme Court recognized that corporations don't have a privilege against self-incrimination, because that's something that a natural human has but can't be held derivatively. And finally, we get to all of this putting into context the much more recent and expansive development of rights associated with speech and the First Amendment more broadly. And I'll break that down into commercial speech, rights in politics, and religious rights, as Professor Bella Torres' book did in her book. So to the next slide. What I want to note here is that the jurisprudence recognizing corporate speech rights and First Amendment rights is of the most recent vintage and has arguably reflected the greatest expansion of corporate rights. It's a huge expansion in just the past 40 years, really, and it's important to keep that in perspective. It wasn't a given that corporations would have speech rights or rights of comparable breadth as individuals enjoy. The court has, as I noted previously, recognized limitations to the rights of corporations vis-a-vis individuals. For instance, holding corporations don't have that Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination, that corporations are not citizens under the Privileges and Immunities Clause. Corporations don't have voting rights under the 14th, 5th, 19th, or 24th Amendments. And with limited exception, the question of corporate speech didn't come up until the 1970s. And those limited exceptions before that time involved associational and speech rights of nonprofit organizations such as the NAACP and media corporations like newspapers. And those cases were limited and specific to the corporations involved. The early cases involving media corporations focused on the freedom of press and First Amendment, not on their status as the parties as corporations. But in the 1970s, there was a significant shift. And in many ways, I think that's where the story starts for the topics that are being discussed today. Of course, corporate rights go back 200 years. But the 1970s is really when most of what we're dealing with now regarding the First Amendment started. And it started with important cases such as Virginia Pharmacy and Bilotti that started to protect commercial and political spending rights of corporations more generally. And a new direction in corporate rights jurisprudence began to emerge. Professor John Coates' empirical analysis shows that now nearly half of First Amendment legal challenges benefit business corporations and trade groups rather than other kinds of organizations or individuals. And I think that really starts to put this into perspective, that what we're talking about is a relatively recent phenomenon in interpretation. And we're now talking about a substantial amount of protections and use of those protections that's going on. So in the interest of time, I'd like to now just say a bit about the big recent cases in the three areas related to the First Amendment. First, on commercial speech, the compelled speech doctrine is now being used to object to a variety of government regulations that require disclosure. And in fact, now we even have something that's being referred to as compelled commercial speech doctrine to strike down mandatory commercial disclosures. So for example, in the past few years, we've seen the DC Circuit case striking down the SEC's rulemaking on conflict mineral disclosures for public corporations. That is public corporations for many years have had required disclosures. That's part of federal securities laws. In fact, that's part of what defines them as public companies. But the D.C. Circuit struck down the SEC's rule requiring a disclosure on conflict minerals under the First Amendment. In Sorrell v. IMS, the Supreme Court held that a Vermont statute that restricted the sale and disclosure and use of records of doctors' prescribing practices violated the First Amendment. And so we see a much more robust use of it's hard to even know if we should still call it the commercial speech doctrine in some ways, because it's really expanded in significant ways. And the court has also started to apply, in some instances, a higher level of scrutiny. It seems an inquiry into content-based reasoning. In politics, of course, we have Citizens United from 2010, referenced in the introduction, and I'm sure will be talked about a lot today. And what the court did in Citizens United was further expand corporate political speech rights by invalidating a federal ban on corporate expenditures from general treasury funds for electronic communications for guest candidates. So the key change with Citizens United was allowing companies to fund from their corporate treasury as much as they want independent expenditures and electioneering communications, which previously they would have had to fund only through a political action committee. And the ruling was broad as to all corporations. So all of the little images that you see on this slide, it's as to all corporations, whether it's a nonprofit political advocacy group, as was involved in the Citizens United case, or if it's, you know, Walmart or Coca-Cola or Google or whatnot. As to religion, we have the Supreme Court's recent decision in Hobby Lobby, amongst a bunch of other cases. But the novel question before the court in Hobby Lobby was, I think, particularly important because what was at stake was whether or not a for-profit corporation could opt out of a generally applicable regulation. And specifically, it was about the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, RFRA, and whether it applied to business corporations like Hobby Lobby and the others in the case. And specifically, whether the Department of Health regulations with the Affordable Care Act violated RFRA as applied to those corporations. And the court ruled that it did because it extended RFRA protections to corporations, quote, because it protects the religious liberty of the humans who own and control these companies. And from my perspective, why Hobby Lobby is such a landmark decision and from my perspective, concerning is because for the first time, the court allowed business corporations to opt out of a generally applicable federal regulation because of the beliefs of the shareholders. So now that I've done some framing groundwork, I'd like to just add a few reflections from my work in recent articles and book chapters. First, the thing that I think really bears more emphasizing is that the spectrum of corporations that exist and the line drawing is what is so difficult here and where I think the Supreme Court has gone wrong. In an article with Margaret Blair, I traced with Margaret the Supreme Court corporate rights jurisprudence over the past 200 years. And we even pulled, you know, as part of that project, we, together with research assistants that deserves credit too, we pulled all of the cases that involved corporations making a constitutional claim before the Supreme Court. And so we looked at even the little cases that aren't the famous ones. And what we found was that although the Supreme Court hasn't been entirely consistent in its logic, there was an underlying rationale to the cases up through much of the 20th century. And it really was to protect the people involved in the corporation. But by the late 19th century, there were huge multinational companies already starting to grow. And they didn't function as associations of citizens. And the Supreme Court never figured out how to treat these different corporations. And so I think the problem, from my perspective, with cases like Citizens United and Hobby Lobby, is that the court didn't get the line drawing correct, and it went too far. It gave rights broadly to all corporations in Citizens United instead of just the nonprofit political advocacy group. And it gave Hobby Lobby an opt-out of a generally applicable law. And
Elizabeth, I'm going to ask you to stop there just for purposes of time and hang with us. The reason I'm cutting you off, and I do want to recommend for folks to go to Elizabeth Pollman's website at the University of Loyola, and you can actually download the paper she's talking about. Tell us the name of it again.
That paper is called The Derivative Nature of Corporate Rights.
Yes, and I was reading it last night, and it's very good. The reason I'm cutting you off, and you can't see this, but I don't have slides, but I do have a visual aid, which is this index card. You have a bunch of these at your tables and on the seats back there, and the reason they're there is as our speakers make their presentations, we're hoping that you will write down your burning questions and pass them up here to me, and I will collate them and sort them, and when we're done with our presentations, we hope to have lots of smart questions from all of you smart people. So anyway, I want to get on to our next speaker, and I will say that Elizabeth's reference to the conflict minerals case was interesting to me because it does demonstrate kind of this extraterritorial action that corporations are able to take. I worked with a group of journalists who were following that case, and the assumption was that whatever the United States did in terms of forcing corporations to disclose their conflict minerals or not would then affect what the EU did. So what happens here is very, very important internationally, and it was part of a very much international legal strategy. Our next speaker is Jennifer Taub. She is from the University of Vermont, and like everybody on this panel, except for me, she is not just an academic. All of the people on this panel don't just study corporate law and write about corporate law, they have walked the walk. Jennifer worked for an investment house, correct? And Ciara worked as a corporate lawyer, and Elizabeth was part of a startup in Silicon Valley. So I think these are folks who know a lot about, they know whereof they speak. And Jennifer, take it away. She is also, I should add, a dedicated Facebooker. And besides being an academic, she's starting a march on Washington, which she can tell you about. And I don't know how she has time to do her academic writing because she is writing pretty much hourly, I think, about President Trump and what's going on in DC.
Hello? Thanks.
Yes, there you go.
Well, thank you so much for that introduction. And also, I want to thank Ciara Torres-Spelliscy and her team here at Stetson College of Law for organizing this symposium. And I'm so glad to participate, especially now. First, a disclaimer, I am not a constitutional law scholar. My areas of research are corporate governance, financial market regulation, and more recently, white-collar crime. However, my work often focuses on Supreme Court decisions, and that includes Citizens United, which we've already started to talk about corporate political spending. Also, Sundiamond from 1999 and McDonald from 2016 that focus on bribery. I find that these decisions help illuminate how money corrupts the electoral process and how money also corruptly and sometimes illegally can influence the official acts of elected and appointed government officials. I've written a few scholarly articles on this topic, in, specifically corporate constitutional rights and corporate political spending. And what the work does is to draw attention to the ways in which corporate managers have misaligned incentives when they secretly use the corporate treasury funds, essentially the corporate checkbook, to spend money on political activities. There are many harms that stem from this behavior. This harms both shareholders and the public. The spending may not actually benefit the firm itself. Sometimes the corporate CEO is spending to further their own future political aspirations. It also may go against the shareholders' political leanings, canceling out their own voice. And moreover, the general public is in the dark as to who's funding political advertisements, part of what constitutional law scholars talk about when they talk about First Amendment speech rights is the right to hear, the right to listen. And you're not really able to listen or hear accurately if you don't know the identity of the speaker. As Professor Pollman has talked about, the Supreme Court has been rather inconsistent, if not incoherent, on the basis upon which they recognize certain corporate constitutional and statutory rights. What I believe my contribution so far to this discussion has been is the recognition that institutional investors, the role they play in this process. And I'll touch on that in a moment. But my talk today, I'm trying to be, I think my general way of being around these issues is to be hopeful and to focus on what we can do now. So I'm going to talk about constitutionally permissible means to limit two things. First, what we've already started talking about, corporate political spending. And second, a twist on this, what I'm calling political corporate spending. So let me tell you what I mean by both of these. So corporate political spending is this, again, this idea of the CEO of a large company whose shares are a private firm whose shares are held by the public using the corporate treasury. So this is using the corporate checkbook to spend for political spending in U.S. elections. This is done typically without shareholder knowledge or consent and without the listener's knowledge. This influences the political process and it affects who gets elected. You can be for, put out praising ads or attack ads for those that you oppose. And this isn't just about who gets elected, but it opens the door and gives the spenders access to influence decisions that are later made. And this is even without separate lobbying expenditures. And there's a great example. I just heard mentioned from Kathy that I am a Facebooker, but sadly I also use Twitter. And I'm actually going to open my Twitter right now. I know this is very unorthodox to tell you because there is an example in today's feed, a perfect example of what's happening right now, how threats of or promises of future spending, political spending to support candidates in elections can impact not after the fact, but before the fact behavior right now. So I'm not sure if you all saw this, but the Koch brothers apparently have pledged and made known, they're pledging millions of dollars to Republican candidates who vote against Trump care, or I guess maybe it's not called that, maybe it's called the repealing and replacing or the amending of the Affordable Care Act. Right now as we're talking, the votes may be happening. I don't know, I promise not to
Friday,
check on that.
Friday.
But the point of this is, this was always a veiled threat, right? And it's not just coming from the Republican side, right? It comes from Democrats who have money as well. This idea that at all times when an elected official is making decisions, they have to keep in their mind the prospect of re-election, especially in the House where they're re-elected every 2 years, right? The senators have 6 years, but depending on where you are in your cycle of re-election, if you want to be re-elected so that you can make the changes that support your constituents that you were elected to do, you always have in mind that someone could be supporting you or attacking you. And that threat, I was pretty astonished to see that made so completely clear right now in the center of this contentious debate. So that's what I mean by corporate political spending. What do I mean by political corporate spending? I'm using that term today to talk about this sort of flip, what we see now with our current presidential administration, where we have, if corporate political spending is the CEO reaching into the pocket of the shareholders to spend on political activities, right? Political corporate spending is when the elected official, for example, perhaps the president, uses the U.S. Treasury, the U.S. checkbook, to benefit his own corporations and himself, and also taking payments from foreign governments to, again, benefit the corporate bottom line. So it's kind of the flip. Similarly, just as with corporate political spending happening without shareholders' knowledge and consent, this spending is happening without with Americans' full knowledge or consent. So that's the bad news. But the great news is that we have legal remedies available to us right now. And it seems clear that the Constitution empowers the Congress to act to stop both types of corruption, yet they won't. And in certain cases, they're actively, and I think Lisa Gilbert will probably talk about this later, Congress is actively actually standing in the way of agencies who want to create transparency around corporate political spending. So I just want to say, as misguided as the Citizens United decision is from a corporate law perspective, and I'll get into the kind of wonky corporate law details, right? As misguided as that is, and as troubling as we might see the stage of crony capitalism today in light of what's happening in the presidential administration, as troubling as that all is, what's more troubling and astonishing is that we have incredibly powerful tools to address this, but they're not being used. Okay, so what can we do now? Looking at the corporate political spending issue, in Citizens United, the majority, eight of the nine, we used to have nine, you may know that, right, Supreme Court justices, eight of the nine signed on to section 4 of the decision. This is a tremendous open door. Some of you who've studied this decision may know what I'm talking about, but if you don't, this is a part of the Citizens United majority decision where the court made it clear that it's constitutional to create mandates and to regulate disclosure of political spending. And so even though this decision allowed for unlimited amounts of corporate political spending using the corporate treasury funds, we can, in part, not completely, remedy that through disclosure. Now, as I noted, you know, Congress is actively preventing this. There have been more than 1 million people who signed on to a letter asking the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, to enact a rulemaking that would require corporations that are listed firms to report annually their spending, corporate political spending. And despite that, the SEC didn't act on that. And then kind of unbelievably, Congress passed a law blocking the SEC from enacting a final rule requiring that. So that's pretty astonishing. The Supreme Court opened the door to sunlight, and the Congress is trying to shut that door despite that the public is very interested in this. So focusing on this, when I say a door is opened, I think the door is more than just disclosure, because I don't think disclosure of political spending is enough, right? I actually think there's big problems with money in politics, and I thought McCain-Feingold was a fine law and that it provided those limits. So beyond limiting disclosure, I believe that the Supreme Citizens United also permits Congress or the states to require actual shareholder consent prior to certain types of corporate political spending. And let me explain why it's needed and what I mean by consent. Sometimes folks say shareholders all they need is disclosure at best, because if they see that the corporation in which they're invested is spending on candidates and campaigns they don't like, they can do the Wall Street walk, meaning vote with their feet, sell their shares. But actually that's not the case, and let me explain why. We think of shareholders as these people like you and I who may be holding, have equity investments, own direct shares in a company. But our largest U.S. companies, between 2/3 and 3/4 of the shares are held by institutional investors like mutual funds. And that includes not just an actively managed mutual fund, but an index fund. And as you know, an index fund holds stock in shares of an index. There are no choices about holding it. If the stock is in the index, it must be held. So an index fund cannot do the Wall Street walk, cannot sell their shares. And people who own mutual funds can't require the mutual fund, whether it's an index fund or an active fund, to sell their shares. Those decisions are being made by the direct shareholder Yet the person at the end of this chain, the ultimate investor whose savings and money is at risk, whose money is invested in this company, have no ability to walk. They also have no say. They can't. The other thing is vote out the directors. Well, that's a very complicated and not useful process for other reasons. But again, if you're not a direct shareholder, you can't do that. So my suggestion in this front is based on the Supreme Court's rationale, which I want to get to, the incoherent rationale basis upon which they decided that corporations had First Amendment speech rights. Based on that, we should take them at their word and require what I'm about to tell you. So what was that basis? The Supreme Court comes up with different rationales and different theories for the firm when they decide to grant corporate constitutional rights. And with Citizens United and with Hobby Lobby, they did this technique where they looked through the corporate form to the shareholders. So let's just look at Citizens. What the court did not say, the majority did not say Citizens United was a person. That's not true. They looked at the aggregate theory and they said, look, this corporation, it turns out to be a membership corporation in that case. It was not a nonprofit, but they said corporations are just aggregations of individual shareholders, human beings like you and I. And they said in the majority that when, if I'm an individual human being who has the right to spend unlimited amounts of money from my own pocket on corporate ads, on political ads, if I can do that, I shouldn't lose my First Amendment right to spend money on support candidates I like or don't like. I shouldn't lose that right simply because I grouped together with my other friends to start a corporation. Right? So they look through the corporation and say, if the humans have these individual rights, they shouldn't lose those rights simply because they group together their money in the corporate form. Well, if we take that theory at face value, this look-through theory, which by the way, they don't always use a look-through theory to grant constitutional rights. If you use a look-through theory, I would argue that you then need to not just have disclosure, but actually find the real human beings. So if a mutual fund owns 50 or 60% together, mutual funds and institutional investors own 50 or 60% of the shares of a particular corporation, they're not real people. In fact, many mutual funds don't have the right to actually engage in corporate political spending. So let's make sure we have the consent of the real people who engage in this. Okay, so I know I have 1 minute left, but I'm gonna take more than that. I apologize, because the second, I'm just going to, I'm asking for forgiveness, not permission. Sorry, okay.
That's a good technique in the courtroom.
Because this is the really exciting part. I'm gonna talk about emoluments. I know everyone loves that word, right? I now wanna talk about the
This is not a skin product.
Although I do feel in Florida I don't need to use my emollient cream anymore. So at any rate, I'm talking about the others. We talked about corporate political spending. Now we're doing the flip, this sort of political corporate spending. How do we stop an elected official from these kinds of self-dealing activities? Well, when we look at most elected officials, we have statutory provisions like 18 U.S.C. 208 about conflicts of interest. But when we're looking at the U.S. president, that's a different case. So you've heard that there are these constitutional tools. I'm going to talk about two constitutional tools and then some statutory ones. The first you've heard a lot about is what people are called the Emoluments Clause or the Foreign Emoluments Clause. Emolument just means payment. Now there's some disputes, and if you want to actually get into the really interesting disputes about what the scope of what an emolument is, what I recommend is two things. One, the Brookings Institute has a white paper written by Larry Tribe and Norm Eisen. You can download. It's very straightforward and clear and talks about the debates. You can also look at Zephyr Teachout's book, Corruption in America. Also, there are some conflicting views, and those are in the footnotes of the Brookings case, but you can also email me and I can tell you what some of the, I think, less credible views are based on the history of these provisions. Okay, so the Foreign Emoluments Clause is in Article 1 of the Constitution. And for those of you who are law students, you may say, Article 1, why would something about the president be in Article 1? Isn't that congressional authority, right? Yes, it is. Article 1, Section 8 does is, in addition to saying that no office holder including a president, can have a title of nobility. It also forbids, without the consent of the Congress, a president or any other official, federal official, from accepting a present, an emolument of any kind whatever from any king, prince, or foreign state. So that has been interpreted to mean any kind of payment from a foreign government or foreign official. So this impacts not just, arguably, folks who are foreign governments and officials who are renting hotel rooms, let's say, in Trump Organization properties, but any transactions that involve payments or loan loan forgiveness, let's say, from any foreign-owned banks or counterparties. Now, what's interesting about this is that this came from the, this predates the Constitution. It derives from the Articles of Confederation, and it was modeled after a 1651 Dutch rule. This was debated at the Constitutional Convention, and the consent of Congress language was added. So it used to be a flat-out ban. The consent of Congress language was added, perhaps reflecting the fact that Benjamin Franklin, before the Constitution was created, had gotten congressional approval, notwithstanding the Articles of Incorporation, to take a diamond-encrusted snuffbox from a foreign government official. Okay, so also it was mentioned at the Virginia Ratifying Convention, and a gentleman named Edmund Jennings Randolph made it very clear that this applied to the president and said that violating this provision would be an impeachable offense. The purpose of this provision was to twofold: to end this kind of gift-giving practices from Europe, but also to reject corruption and foreign influence. The idea is that if someone gives you some expensive gift, you're going to owe them something. Okay. Second thing is the domestic emoluments clause. This is a great one too. It doesn't give as much attention. It's in Article 2, Section 1, Clause 7. This is really interesting because it basically says the president's only salary is the salary he is given, and he should not receive any other emolument from either the U.S. Or any states. So that means his salary is his salary. Now, what's interesting, and he should not be getting any other kinds of compensation. Now, this is particularly interesting because there's no carve-out for congressional approval. Where does that leave us? How could this apply? Well, there's some questions when, for example, you have Secret Service protection staying in a building you own and you are charging them for it. If it's a market rate, maybe that's okay. It's not entirely clear. There are other types of benefits that a president could get. Also, there's some statutory tools. Statutes include 18 U.S.C. 201. This is prohibits quid pro quo bribery. I'm not gonna get into that because I know my time is up, but I will say, if you're wondering, besides going back to the Constitutional Convention, if this has ever come up, don't believe the account saying no one's ever talked about this before. No, this has come up a number of times, including when President Obama was to get the Nobel Prize. And there were many commentators saying this would violate the Emoluments Clause. You also remember concerns about corruption that have come up before implicating the Constitution and the quaint days when President Jimmy Carter, I think, had to sell his peanut farm. That really looks like peanuts now, but thank you.
Thank you very much. I will just offer from my perspective in Washington, D.C., a citizen of the colony of Columbia, as I like to call it, a couple of points to underscore what Jennifer said. One, this will show you what a weird geek I am, but I was watching the White House press briefing one Friday a couple of weeks ago and noticed that Sean Spicer, the president's press secretary, referred to the fact that the president would be traveling that afternoon to the winter White House, meaning Mar-a-Lago. And I was just shocked by this. And I was shocked because I had never heard a press secretary use that term. And I checked with some people who were even older than me, and I said, have you ever heard this? Reporters often use that nickname for, you know, when Nixon would go to Key Biscayne or et cetera. But I'd never heard a press secretary use it from the White House podium. And it struck me that that was branding. And sure enough, I checked, and the dues at Mar-a-Lago have been increased I think they've been doubled since President Trump was elected. So that's an interesting fact to think about. And then the second thing is, there are a lot of businesses in Washington. In fact, there's even been a lawsuit filed by a small wine bar in Washington that say they're losing business to the Trump Tower in Washington, D.C., which opened during the campaign. And it's located not too far from the White House. And a lot of business from foreign embassies is now going to that hotel, as opposed to other hotels, of which there are many in Washington. So
can I chime in on that? I know, sorry, I'm breaking all the rules here. But it's interesting that you mentioned that. There is an argument that that upcharge, you know, for not the Winter White House, but for a private club owned by the president, is arguably a violation of the Domestic Emoluments Clause. The lawsuit by Cork Wine Bar, which I just visited and had a drink on Tuesday when I was in Washington. They're lovely people there. That lawsuit isn't under, it's not under the Emoluments Clause. You probably know they brought that lawsuit under a D.C. unfair competition statute. And there's also one now being brought in California against, I think, Ivanka Trump's businesses under a similar unfair competition statute. I mean, we could talk a lot about a lot of different angles here.
Okay, and I really don't need to introduce the next speaker to Stetson, but I will say that Ciara Torres-Spelliscy has been a real inspiration to me. She's a remarkable person. I've worked with her in several different lives, and her book is terrific, and I learned a lot reading it, and I hope that all of you have too. And before she starts, I'm going to remind you, all you smart people out there, don't leave all the questioning to the corporatist elitist media. We want to hear from you, so send your questions up.
Right. Good morning. I knew my students were here. Okay. My name is Ciara Torres-Spelliscy, and I teach here at Stetson. And the title of my talk today is Waiting for the Corrupt Shoe to Drop. And I hope by the end of my talk, you will understand what I mean by that. But let me start here. This is a picture of my dad, and he was an artist and a very creative thinker. And when I was a youngster, he would say to me, Ciara, remember to ask the big questions. And the big question that I've been wrestling with for about a decade now is, what is the proper role of corporate money in government? And this was the subject of my first book, which Professor Pollman was so generous in talking about. And I think it's going to be the subject of my second book, which has the working title, Political Brands. I've become really, really fascinated about the convergence between commercial advertising and political advertising. And lucky for me, my book is writing itself. And I almost feel like all I have to do is, you know, lie back and let the headlines wash over me. And here are a few of them that show that the issue of political branding is really front and center. But one of the things that I'll have to do with a little bit more care is look at what happened in the 2016 election. And one of the narratives that I feel I need to correct is one that I hear from very intelligent people from both ends of the political spectrum. And what the narrative is this, that the election of Donald Trump proves that money in politics doesn't matter anymore. And my response to this is hogwash. And the reason that my response to this is hogwash is during the 2016 election, I had to keep track of political spending. It's a occupational hazard when you work on money and politics. And the most useful metric during the 2016 election was measuring in billions. And this is what I mean by that. So Trump and his PACs spent about a third of $1 billion. Clinton and her PACs spent half a billion. If you added all of the presidential candidates, including those in the primaries, that was over $2 billion. The Senate races clocked in at three-fourths of $1 billion. The House races cost $1 billion. The Democratic Party spent $1 billion. The Republican Party spent just shy of $1 billion. And there were also state races where the data is still trickling in. And at this point, that's nearly $1.5 billion for the state candidates as well. And corporations were also using their Citizens United rights during this election. And I'm sorry, the print gets a little small, but the top publicly traded company that was spending in the 2016 election was Chevron, and they spent most of their money trying to elect Republicans to both houses of Congress. And they were in good company. There were lots of publicly traded companies that spent in that election. But those two slides probably undercount the amount of corporate political spending that happened in that election, because we have this huge dark money problem. And by dark money, I mean the public cannot tell where that money originated. And since Citizens United, there has been at least $750 million of dark money spent. And I expect with this new midterm election, we will finally get to $1 billion in dark money. So the way that dark money gets dark is it goes through an opaque nonprofit. And so you have a corporation that doesn't want to spend under its doing business as name. It will spend through a 501c4, which is a social welfare organization, or a 501c6, which is a trade association. And once it goes through that black box, the public simply cannot tell who paid for the political ads that they are seeing. And this has been a concern not just to election lawyers, it's been a concern to corporate lawyers as well. And so corporate lawyers have asked the Securities and Exchange Commission for a new rule to end dark money. So the good news is a million of my fellow citizens decided to take time out of their day to write to the Securities and Exchange Commission and also ask for an anti-dark money rule. The bad news is the Securities and Exchange Commission has not promulgated such a rule. Okay, so all of that was talking about the legal corporate political spending. Let's get to the more interesting stuff, which is the illegal corporate political spending. Now, I started my career as an attorney, as a corporate lawyer. And one of the things I didn't like about being a corporate lawyer is I kept on running into white-collar criminals. And my firm actually repped Martha Stewart during her case. And so I thought if I got out of corporate law, I would get away from white-collar crime. But sadly, the white-collar criminals follow me around, and it was like jumping out of the frying pan and into the fire. Now, when you work on money and politics, you learn really weird things. Because when people are breaking the law, they get sort of creative and bizarre at times. And this presents a problem for me as both an attorney and a scholar, because I don't want my credibility to be ruined because I believed a fake news story or I believed a conspiracy theory. And so one of the things that I have to do all of the time is hold my fire and make sure that I wait until the indictment is actually released or the guilty conviction has already been given by a jury. So I wanted to give you a couple of examples of some of the totally bizarre things that have come across my radar screen in the past couple of years. So one of them was this. I started getting questions from journalists and sometimes from fellow advocates that went something like this. Do you have any comment on the campaign finance documents that were found in the meth house? And my response to this was, I have no idea what you're talking about. That sounds totally bizarre. And no, I don't have any comment. But it turns out that this was real. There were real campaign finance documents found in a real meth house. And when investigators looked at those documents, they were from a dark money group. And that dark money group was spending in Montana elections. They were not being transparent, as Montana law required. And some of the money that they were hiding was corporate. Another totally bizarre story that happened was I started getting questions like this. Do you have any comment on the foreign pornographer who's spending in the California elections? And my response to this was, I have no idea what you're talking about. I don't know if that's true. I don't know if he's a pornographer. I don't know if he's spending in the elections. No comment. But it turns out that this individual, he's German, is a pornographer. And he was spending illegally in a Los Angeles election in 2012. And when the California authorities figured this out, they fined him because it was illegal for a foreign national to spend in an election like that. So this is my current mood. This is some poor individual with shoes falling on their head. And for someone who studies political corruption, this is a target-rich environment. Both when I look at the 2016 election and our current administration. And so I am watching multiple storylines and I am trying to hold my fire and I'm waiting for investigations to be done and I'm waiting for indictments to be brought. But here are the three stories that have really caught my attention. Number one. Last summer, there were reports both in the press and from Parliament, as in Parliament in England, that they were receiving solicitations from the Trump campaign asking for political donations. So this is illegal. It's illegal for a candidate for federal office to ask for money from a foreign individual. It is also illegal for the foreign individual to give money to a candidate for federal election in the United States. But there have been no indictments on this, and so we don't know how this story is going to end. Story number two, and I'm probably not alone here. I am deeply concerned about the ongoing investigation by the FBI into Russian influence over the American election. And what caught my eye in this McClatchy's piece was the word aid. So aid could mean that it's just the DNC hacking that we've all heard about. Aid could also mean money going to the Trump campaign from the Kremlin. And so I'm waiting, like everyone else, to find out what the FBI finds when they do this investigation. And then finally, there's this piece in the New Yorker by Adam Davidson, which raises very deep questions about the relationship between the Trump Organization and a hotel in Azerbaijan and possibly the Iranians. And one of the things that this New Yorker piece raises is a potential violation of the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And so I thought I could tell you a little bit about the history of why we have the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act and what that act actually does. So the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act is a post-Watergate reform. Watergate is the scandal that brought down Richard Nixon. And the story starts here. This is a picture of the Watergate, which is where the DNC's headquarters was back in 1972. And because of a bungled burglary at the Watergate, we get investigations by Woodward and Bernstein, pictured here, who were Washington Post reporters, and they decided to follow the money. Congress also held extensive hearings into the Watergate burglary and the Nixon re-election campaign, and it turned out that those two things were linked. So the burglary at the Watergate was paid for by the Committee to Re-Elect the the president, otherwise known as CREEP. And CREEP got some of its money from these corporations, all of which still exists. Gulf Oil is now known as Chevron. And the problem with that is getting corporate money into a presidential campaign is illegal. It was illegal in the 70s. It's still illegal today because of a law called the Tillman Act. So as a result of Watergate, Nixon resigns, and Congress passes comprehensive campaign finance reform. But I think a lesser known story is what happened over at the Securities and Exchange Commission. So they too were watching the Watergate hearings. And the head of enforcement at the Securities and Exchange Commission asked this really basic question. How are these publicly traded companies giving these illegal donations to the Nixon campaign? And he asked, do they have an account called bribery? So he opened up an inquiry and he asked publicly traded companies, please tell us what you were up to in this area. And an astonishing 500 companies stepped forward and said, we too have what the SEC called political slush funds. And the money wasn't just going to the Nixon campaign, it was going to Democrats, and it was going to bribe foreign officials abroad. And the SEC was really troubled by this because it was not being properly accounted for, which meant that investors were getting potentially materially misleading financials out of these corporations. So the SEC actually took the lead in asking Congress for a new law, and that is what became the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And it has two big components. One, it requires publicly traded companies to keep accurate books and records, and it bars American companies from using political bribes to get or keep business. And this includes campaign spending abroad. And Titan was hit with a hefty fine for violating this part of the FCPA. The FCPA was heavily enforced during the Obama administration. So last year, they had about two dozen enforcements, and that brought in $2.4 billion. And already this year, Cadbury has run afoul of the FCPA because of bribes related to a chocolate factory in India. But the US Chamber of Commerce hates this law. They've hated it for all of its existence. And they think that it is unfair to US businessmen that they cannot bribe when individuals from other countries can. And they have a new ally. When Donald Trump was a candidate, he said on CNBC that the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act is a horrible law and that it should be changed and that it puts US businesses at a huge disadvantage. And this issue of enforcing the FCPA came up at the confirmation hearing of our new AG. And it actually required him to give a written response. And so we have in writing, yes, if confirmed as Attorney General, I will enforce all federal laws, including the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. And so I am waiting to see how this administration enforces the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, especially if any of their investigations touch the Trump Organization. And I want to know how this story ends as an author, because I want to put it in my second book. But more seriously, I want to know how this story ends as a citizen, because I feel like my democracy is at stake. Thank you.
Okay, it's time for questions, so send them all up. In the meantime, I'll take the moderator's privilege and ask one of my own. I also wanted to close the loop on a couple of things that Ciara said because I thought she made some excellent points. One of the things that journalists talk about, especially now, I'm seeing it a lot in journalist listservs that I talk to, is You know, Watergate, if any of you have seen the movie All the President's Men, or you should, the journalists were really the heroes. And back then, you know, journalists weren't so unpopular. But it really wasn't journalism that brought an end to the Nixon administration. It was ultimately the People's House, the Congress. And had it not been for the subpoena power and the doggedness and the willingness of members of both parties in both chambers to take on, to really pick up the ball where the journalists had left it, we wouldn't have, we would have had a full second term of the Nixon administration. We'd not have had campaign finance reform. We wouldn't have had the transparency, the bars against corporate spending or bribery that we have today. And I think both of our last speakers, Jennifer and Ciara, alluded to this. The Federal Communications Commission and the Securities and Exchange Commission both have been asked to enforce different regulations that would allow more transparency of corporate spending, and neither agency has done so. And in both cases, the chairs of that agency are widely reported to have been intensely pressured during their confirmation hearings by Congress not to take those enforcement actions. And so I think the question now is going to be, what kind of congressional will is there to counterbalance executive power? And I think that's going to be a really interesting thing to watch. So those are my two journalistic cents. And I want to start with a first question for all of the panelists, including Elizabeth, who I think is still with us. Are you there, Elizabeth?
Yep, I'm still
yes,
here.
Good. Okay. I just wondered, I assume that you all, as legal geeks, have been following the confirmation hearings for Neil Gorsuch. And given what you've heard and what you know of his record as a judge, how do you think if he were to be confirmed, how might that affect the Supreme Court in terms of some of this case law that might come before it? What's the first big decision that you could see? Is there something in the pipeline? And what, if anything, does Judge Gorsuch's record or his answers to the Judiciary Committee tell us about how he might vote? Elizabeth, we haven't heard from you. Do you want to start? Because I can't make eye contact.
Oh, no worries. I was just thinking that's a great question for Jennifer. Because Jennifer's also written quite a bit about Hobby Lobby, so I was curious. I think Jennifer should start.
Oh, no, Elizabeth, that would be so unfair to you. You can go ahead. Okay. I began my remarks by saying that I'm not a constitutional law scholar, and although I was teaching and in meetings, so I did not watch the confirmation hearing, not even one second of it. I was also watching another hearing. The only information I have about that is what I read in news accounts. I guess there's two things. One, this is a hypothetical. We don't actually know that he will be confirmed. One thing that I did see noted online was that he may have misstated the holding in Citizens United. And maybe Chara knows a bit more about this. My understanding is he thinks that it gives more leeway to regulate corporate political spending. Before I hand it over to her, though, I want to make a distinction. I think you all know this, but it came up in my mind when Tara was talking, which is there is a bit of a weird situation here where a corporation cannot directly give, you know, this to the political campaign, right? But it can spend unlimited amounts of money, you know, transparently or through these different channels, you know, hiding the funds. It can give to a super PAC, for example, or to again, mask the funding through give money somewhere else that gives it to the super PAC. So a super PAC that's, you know, I'm going to say independent in quotes of the campaign can get unlimited amounts of money. No limit, not the typical limits from individuals, no limits from corporations, right? Whereas, and they can have devoted to a single candidate. Whereas the campaign itself has limits on how much you can get from real humans and cannot get money from a corporation itself. Okay, so that's really interesting because it puts a lot of weight on this word independent. And the problem with that is, and the rules are you can't coordinate between, you know, the super PAC and the campaign. You can't coordinate if you're doing your own independent ads. But how hard is it to see what the campaign is doing and just amplify it? Also, the rules of what it means to coordinate seem not to have materialized, and there doesn't seem to be much enforcement. There seems to be people who are friendly both at the campaign and at the super PAC. So I think to some degree it's so easy for corporations just to not give directly to the campaign. It's surprising to me that we had the situation where you had foreign individuals or foreign companies giving to campaigns because they have other legal ways to have the exact same impact without doing that. I know that I dodged the main question a bit, so I let Ciara answer it for
okay,
me.
Okay, I'm going to interject just to say, because I'm a campaign finance geek, and there are really several different ways that a corporation can influence politics or the outcome of an election. As you've heard, corporations cannot give directly to a candidate's campaign committee. So ExxonMobil can't just write a check on the ExxonMobil treasury to candidate X. However, corporations can have, and most of them do, political action committees. And it might be called ExxonMobil PAC or ExxonMobil Employees for a Better Government, something like that. And those PACs are strictly limited. There's a ceiling on how much they can give. I believe this year it's $10,000 per campaign. Another way you see corporate influence is individuals who donate are supposed to list their employer. And so oftentimes you'll see a whole bunch of contributions coming in on the same day from people who work for Corporation X. So that's another way corporate influence can be exercised in a very transparent way, which is handy for the corporations because it does let the candidates know quite clearly who's giving to them. The second way is giving through a super PAC, which is called a super PAC because for arcane rules, we have a real Rube Goldberg system of campaign finance regulation, and super PACs can give a lot more money to candidates, but they do have to disclose who their donors are. The third way is dark money, and dark money is money that goes through a 501c4 or 6 corporation, meaning a trade association or a social welfare group. I'd like to see how many swing sets Citizens United has built. But at any rate, a lot of corporations give either to the Chamber of Commerce or labor unions also, although they have to give much more disclosure through the Department of Labor. But these 501Cs do not have to disclose publicly where they get their money. And that is why it's dark. And that is why you hear the concerns about, because foreign corporations, foreign people cannot give money to influence U.S. elections under U.S. law. But if you give that money through a 501c, how do we know?
And can I just say that those two things get the most nefarious piece is when you combine those last things. So you can give the money to the 501c4 that then gives to the super PAC. And so when the super PAC discloses its funders, it discloses the name of the 501c4.
Right. And you see a lot of that. We call it dead-end disclosure. So somebody will give money, a super PAC gives $100,000 to influence an election, and you look at who their donors are, and it's a 501c with the same name. So you don't know who gave that money. And what often happens, it's almost in 3/4 or more of the cases, it's a negative campaign expenditure made late in the campaign. And in cases like Ciara mentioned, money, the $1.4 billion, B as in boy, that's been given in state races, those races don't get nearly the scrutiny that the presidential race or U.S. Senate races get. An expenditure like that coming late in the campaign can tip the balance, and basically you've bought a legislator. So anyway, okay. Neil Gorsuch.
Yes. So I've been trying to be as fair as I can to Neil Gorsuch because I don't think any of us is the devil that our enemies would caricature us as being. That being said, and I've written two op-eds on Mr. Gorsuch, one talking about his opinion in a case called Riddle, which is a campaign finance case that arose out of Colorado. And then I also wrote about his opinion in Hobby Lobby. So he is on the 10th Circuit. He has written actually relatively little on campaign finance. What I was impressed by is his carefulness in the Riddle case. Campaign finance from the perspective of a circuit court judge is complicated because the Supreme Court has left the lower courts with a mess to navigate. And I thought that he did that navigation of the current jurisprudence actually very carefully. And that I find very encouraging. But in his confirmation hearing, and it could just be that he was tired. I mean, these are grueling 10-hour sessions. At one point, he, I think, misstates the implications of Citizens United. And what he said, and he is talking to a group of senators on the Judiciary Committee, he said, you, as in Congress, are able, after Citizens United, to enact expenditure limits. And this left me scratching my head, because that is just not true as a matter of where the law is. After Buckley, like since the 1970s, the Congress has not been able to have expenditure limits for individuals. And after Citizens United, they can't have expenditure limits for corporations or unions. So I have no idea what he was envisioning when he said that Congress would have the power to have expenditure limits post Citizens United. And I don't know whether that was just him misspeaking because of fatigue, or if it belies a deeper misunderstanding of what Citizens United really did to our law.
Okay, question from the audience. I'm going to start with the sort of meta existential question here. Is there any connection between a corporation's goal of maximizing profits and its spending in elections? Or are they, or could those be countervailing goals in some cases?
So some of the corporate law scholarship, including work by, I think, John Coates and Robert Jackson, John of Harvard, Robert Jackson of Columbia, suggests that that's actually not necessarily working in that way. And let me just say, I think when you say something like maximizing shareholder profit, for some people, that's not a bad thing. I'm not going to say that's a bad goal, right? There are, you know, there are corporate governance scholars who think shareholder primacy is the right approach, and long-term shareholder profit maximization is good, right? So that's one thing. There are others who think that corporations should focus on a broader group of stakeholders. So we can just put that out there. But in terms of, for those who would argue or be in the first camp, who really believe in both shareholder primacy and shareholder profit maximization within the bounds of the law, there's evidence to suggest that corporate managers are not spending money in ways to maximize shareholder value, but instead to further other agendas. So it's the typical agency problem, where they're not necessarily looking out for the best interests of the shareholders. That's what is suggested by some of the literature.
Yeah. I have one thing to add here. I think that if you look at it just from a plain perspective, the spending from a regular ordinary business corporation would be about, in some way, maximizing profits or furthering the for-profit business. Otherwise, it would be, as Jennifer says, typically just expressing the manager's personal views, and they're using the corporate funds to try to further their own personal political perspective. And the problem can be that, I think the way the question was asked, is that the shareholders of the corporation or others for whom this profit-maximizing activity might be done, at least theoretically, might not even want what's going on. Even if it's maximizing for one corporation, the way people hold stock these days might mean that they're holding stock through a big mutual fund, and the tiny gain that there might be, which is really almost immeasurable to the corporation, might actually be against the shareholders' political views or what they would like to see as far as corporate spending in our democracy or whatnot. So that's the situation that we have.
Hey, Elizabeth, can I jump in?
Further, oh, sorry, go what ahead. Corporations are trying to do to make money, but it leads to all of these other issues because of that.
I just jump in with one other comment. We can sort of see that sometimes this can be the third rail and backfire. Back when Target had given to a particular campaign, there was a boycott. We see recently what's happened with various companies. It's tricky now, right? Where companies are supporting certain things that the administration does or saying they oppose the travel ban, all these things are starting to really create, impacting, maybe actually backfiring if you're talking about that. But sorry, one other point though, some people say, well, this is, you know, it's fine, let it sort itself out in the marketplace if, you know, that CEOs will be disciplined and understand they shouldn't get into this because look what will happen, there'll be a boycott of customers. But a lot of large companies make their money not from retail expenditures, but sort of from businesses with other businesses, so that discipline doesn't necessarily happen.
It's interesting, there's a former reporter in Washington who's put together a corporate transparency index, and it's voluntary, but he's gotten, I think, more than 200 corporations to voluntarily disclose at least some degree of their political spending. And he told me that one reason corporations are willing to do this is they would really rather not have to pay to play. And so that's one of the really interesting dynamics at play here is donor fatigue. And I think in a way the Supreme Court created a problem for corporate players by lifting the limits, because corporate players used to be able to say, or lobbyists used to say, oh, I'd love to give to you, Joe, but I'm maxed out. And now they can't because of the McCutcheon ruling. But it is interesting that I think some corporations, at least, would rather not do this.
Mm-hmm. And I would just add to that an echo of the discussion of boycotts. One of the things that has happened post Citizens United is app developers, you know, on your smartphone, they have figured out a way that if when you are shopping, you use the camera on your smartphone, you scan the barcode on the back of the product you're about to buy, and what it will spit back at you is information about the political spending of the corporation that produced that product. So some of the apps that are out there are Boycott, Bipartisan, and the buy is B-U-Y in both of those, bipartisan, Boycott. And then there's a app called Second Vote. And Second Vote is really interesting because it is aimed at conservative consumers. And so when you use that app, the information that you get from it is, what was the corporation's position on abortion? What was the corporation's position on gun control? So one of the things that consumers can do now is they have a lot more access to information about the politics of the corporation behind the brands that they are about to purchase. So I think one of the things that corporate managers are going to have to think about going forward is which fight do you want to pick? And when do you want to be aligned with a particular political position? And is it worth it? Is it worth the backlash?
Yeah, and I think that's what really makes the dark money scheme particularly insidious, because if a company wants to avoid that kind of scrutiny, they can merely give the money to a trade association, which then does the dealings for them. So I think, again, but you know, you're seeing some pushback on that too. A number of companies had to leave the Chamber of Commerce because of pushback on the Chamber's stance about climate change. So I think there's, you know, transparency really is an important thing. It was a jurist, Louis Brandeis, who said sunlight is the best of disinfectants. And Chevron, one of the players Ciara alluded to, gave, I think it was something like $3 million to influence a city council race in Richmond, California. And that's a lot of money in a little town. And they lost. And they lost because people knew what was going on. So again, awareness is everything, and transparent. You know, there's still, as a political reporter, I'm as cynical as they come, but I really do trust voters. And if voters are informed and motivated to get out there and vote with the information they have, they can do great things. Okay, our next question is about Hobby Lobby. In that case, was there any mention of a maximum size, national versus multinational, for corporations that could opt out of being regulated by claiming religious freedom? Do you expect corporate religious rights will expand beyond the limits in this case? Who wants to start?
This is such a fascinating question, because when the case first came out, I remember having to read it very quickly because I was going to be answering a journalist's question, and there's no, they rely at, on the term, you know, closely held corporation. So just to back up, remember that Hobby Lobby is not about constitutional rights. It's about it's about rights of certain types of corporations. We don't know the limit actually on those under RFRA, under to have religious, to have access to a statute protecting if they have sincerely held religious beliefs, not having to comply with certain congressional acts. So when we read the decision, the term closely held corporation is used, and yet that's not actually a uniform, there's not a single legal definition to explain what that means. So what was tricky is you would see some news reporting, and journalists would interview maybe a tax lawyer, and they may have one idea of what that means. Corporate law is complicated because, as you folks probably know, if you've taken a business association classes, corporations are incorporated state by state, right? And so state laws don't necessarily use that term. So the question becomes, what is the boundary on this? And this became not a theoretical question, but an actually important question, because after the decision, the Department of Health and Human Services had to then deal with who could get an exemption from providing in the health insurance plan these certain forms of birth control, right? And so they had to come out with a ruling, and there were a lot of folks who wrote letters to the Department of Health and Human Services saying, here's how you should draw the line. And so ultimately, I think it's, right now, at least HHS is drawing the line to much more, you know, to a concept of a corporation that has a small number of shareholders or family type businesses, et cetera. But that's just one agency with one definition. So I don't know.
Does HHS have the ability, now the current HHS, to revisit that, or is that regulation?
Rulemakings can always be revisited if it's gone through the Administrative Procedure Act the same way it was done before.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments?
Yeah.
Elizabeth.
Yeah. What Justice Alito's majority opinion said exactly on that point was that it is unlikely that corporate giants would often assert RFRA claim when the opinion was discussing specifically the argument about how, you know, how broadly will this be applied? Will it apply to big public companies, for example? The court just said it's unlikely that big corporate giants would often assert RFRA claims, but it didn't say what it would do if there was such a claim, and so it left that door open. As Professor Taub mentioned, the departments of health and, you know, other departments ended up needing to define that for purposes of implementing the Hobby Lobby ruling. But in, you know, future cases regarding religious liberty, the court could revisit that. And the Hobby Lobby opinion itself, it expressed doubt that a public corporation would bring a RFRA claim, but nothing in the court's logic definitively imposed that limit.
And I would just add, so Hobby Lobby is decided on statutory grounds that Hobby Lobby, the corporation, can raise a religious objection under RFRA. The next step might be to actually give corporations religious rights under the First Amendment. And if the court goes that way, then it will put more things out of bounds for Congress or state legislatures to regulate corporations who have raised religious objections. Right now, because this is all hinging on RFRA, it does allow Congress the ability, if it wanted to in the future, they could clarify RFRA. I mean, one of the wackier parts of Hobby Lobby is the way that the court gets RFRA to apply to a corporation is they jump out to a different statute called the Dictionary Act, and they look at the definition of the word person, and in the Dictionary Act, it does say that person includes corporations. Well, if you jump back to RFRA only talks about persons, and so under the current jurisprudence, a future Congress, if they were so inclined, could actually clarify RFRA and limit it to human beings. But if the court goes the First Amendment route, if they decide to give corporations a First Amendment religious ability to object, then it's out of bounds for Congress or a state legislature to regulate in that area anymore.
Just to add something else to this, the Alito decision in Hobby Lobby has similar flaws or similar curious logic. Again, they look through a corporate entity to its owners and decide, oh, the corporation is its owners. But when you're depriving the employees of their rights under a federal statute, wouldn't you think you might, instead of looking through, look around to who the corporation is? Why define a corporation for those purposes as its owners? Why not look at the corporation as its employees who actually, you know, ring up the sales at the stores and actually make it exist? And so, again, it's not always when constitutional rights have been granted that they look through. There's no reason why Alito had to say a corporation for these purposes is its owners.
Last question from the audience, unless there are some, send them up now if you want to ask. Why is the SEC the right vehicle to regulate disclosure? And the questioner points out that there are other types of corporations, VC-backed like Uber, private equity, Blackstone, family-owned corporations like the Coke Industries.
Okay. So I'm accused of this all the time, that I asked the wrong thing of the wrong agency. And one of the reasons why I think the Securities and Exchange Commission is actually the proper agency to ask is they actually have a history of regulating certain very narrow aspects of money and politics. So one of the ones I've already mentioned, which is foreign campaign donations, that is regulated under the SEC's authority under the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. They also regulate, they have two anti-pay-to-play rules. One is for in the municipal bond market, and the other is for investment advisors. And the structure of the two anti-pay-to-play rules is basically, if you are giving donations to a entity, like a city, that is going to either sell their bonds or they are investing their public pension fund money with you, and you are the politician who's in charge of that, the structure of the rule is the regulated individuals, the people who are running the, underwriting the bonds or marketing the, or giving it investment advice to the public pension funds. You can't both give big donations and do business with that city at the same time. You have to make a choice. You can give big and not do business with the city, or you can do business with the city and not give big, but you can't do both at the same time. And I think the Securities and Exchange Commission has actually been reasonably good at enforcing these anti-pay-to-play provisions that they have under existing federal law. And so I think if we're talking about publicly traded companies and they are using their Citizens United rights, I think that they should be transparent and they should tell their investors where they are spending in politics and how much they are spending.
And how to capture these other companies?
You go to Delaware. So, I mean, in part, not actually most corporations in America are not publicly traded. It's usually roughly 5% of corporations are publicly traded in the United States. So the other 95%, most of those are incorporated in Delaware. And so I think a long-term project is going to be trying to get more robust shareholder consent rules and shareholder disclosure rules in states like Delaware, where through the internal affairs doctrine, what controls how corporate governance is structured is the state in which that corporation is incorporated.
Do you think, I mean, what would it take, and this is really for the whole panel, is it necessary, I mean, certainly I think, Ciara, in your book you make that argument, to roll back some of the rights that have been extended to corporations or rein them in somehow, and what would that take? I mean, do you, when you talk about the possibility of the Supreme Court giving First Amendment religious freedom rights to corporations under the First Amendment, how likely is that to happen, do you think? And what would it take to turn back this tide?
So we have 1 minute left. And so for different reformers take different approaches to this problem. Some of us start small, and so we work for rules. So rules at the SEC, rules at the FEC, rules at the IRS, rules at the FCC, which all have jurisdiction in one way or another over corporate political spending. So that's the small lift. The heavier lift is going to Congress and getting a new federal statute that requires either disclosure or shareholder consent. And then the maximum lift is trying to amend the Constitution itself. And there is, and we will hear later today, efforts to amend the Constitution to give political speech rights only to human beings instead of to corporate actors as well.
Okay. All right, well, since it's spring training in Florida, we can say the question is, are you gonna swing for the fences or play small ball? But we'll hear more about it later, and I really want to thank the panel. They were great. Thank you, Elizabeth, for getting up so early in California. And on to the coffee break and the next panel.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.